I On behalf of the Pride family, I'd like to welcome you and thank you for being here today, for coming to the celebration of life of Gary Fry. Let's go ahead and begin with a prayer. Father God, it is our honor to be in your presence this morning, in awe of your amazing grace. I pray, Father, that as we celebrate the life of Gary today, we would be reminded of the good memories. I also pray as we mourn for Gary that we would be comforted by the Holy Spirit and encouraged as we look forward to the return of Jesus. May we be reminded that one day there will be no more death, no more crying, no more pain. Thank you, Father, for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to take on our sin so that we may be reconciled with you forever. It is in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Psalm 103, 15 through 18 says, our days are like grass, like wildfire. We bloom and we die. The wind blows and we are gone, as though we had never been here before. But the love of the Lord remains forever with those who fear him. His salvation extends to the children's children of those who are faithful to his covenant, of those who obey his commands. At this time, we're going to sing a song. We're going to sing the Old Rugged Cross. And I'm told that the children are going to start out singing this song. So please, as they sing, listen to words, and then after the first verse, let's sing with them as well. If you are sitting down, you'll find it in your hymn book on page 186. Doris Wilson. They shared great memories of those experiences. Gary attended Arthur High School, where he played basketball and excelled in academics. Eventually graduating with honors, he'd spend his mornings at school and afternoons helping on a family ranch. During his sophomore year, another classmate, Kay Jensen, cooked a meal for him at home. It would be his last first meal made for him by her. He knew he couldn't let her get away. Gary enlisted in the Army January 3rd, 1957, and served until April 2nd, 1959. He and Kay were married on his 10-day leave, December 23rd, 1957, at Arthur Baptist Church. They spent the remaining Army years in Manhattan, Kansas. There they formed lifelong friends Tom and Barbara, and Floyd and Elaine. These couples enjoyed several visits to each other's home states over the years and embarked on other traveling adventures together. Gary and Kay purchased their home ranch 26 miles north of Ashby in 1959. The trail roads were a challenge to move trucks and cattle and household items. Dad often told a story that a neighbor stopped in to greet them to the area, and they had to put all their shop tools and equipment in the living room. On one of the trips to Gordon, they noticed a new building being constructed. The next trip to town confirmed it was the future home of Pleasant Point Community Church. For many years, Gary served as a board member, and it became his forever church home. Gary and Kay hosted countless missionaries on furlough and forged lifelong friendships with those friends. In the early 60s, Pleasant Point Church was working with a new TV station, KBUH, out of Hot Springs, Catesburg. He was part of a quartet called Streaming of Living Water, singing with Lewis Orr, Ev Strasburger, and Norman Hamilton, with Lewis Motet providing the message. In 1960, their first child, Jekka Renee, was born 5 weeks early, disrupting the hay season that year. In November 1963, their son, Gregory J., was born. Gary worked diligently to improve the ranch he purchased. He put two circle irrigation systems and acres of trees. Gary also was instrumental in being on the Cherry County Commission for zoning. In later years, he and Kay spent many years celebrating a large hay contract with the help of their grandkids, South Merriman at the Churn Ranch. He always enjoyed a clean-cut field and rows of beautiful bales. Gary and Kay greatly enjoyed all of their grandkids. Great times were spent fishing, gardening, and playing games, his favorite being Connect Four and Hearts. In the high school years, they drove all over the panhandle calling football, volleyball, and basketball games. Gary moved from his ranch to the Gordon Villa in 2015 and so enjoyed the residents and staff. He grew tomatoes for all his neighbors and friends, and he always had time for a visit. He especially loved visits from his grandkids and his great-grandkids. They were his pride and joy of his life. Gary loved travel and enjoyed their 25th anniversary trip to Montauk. He also enjoyed visiting Branson, Missouri, Florida, and Alaska, and even traveled by train to California with his friends Harold and Dale Glasgow. These two dear friends also enjoyed many years of the Black Hills Stock Show together. They loved flying, and was always quick to share how many trips, at least 7, he made to Georgia to visit Tessa and Natasha. His great adventures, though, was fulfilling a lifelong dream of traveling to Scotland with Tessa. He got to explore Edinburgh, stand on the mountaintops, admire ancient castles, travel through the Isles of the Sky, and pet some hairy cougars. He was fascinated by Scotland because of his family's heritage and origins there, and the stories told by a missionary they'd hosted decades prior. The trip ended with an 8-hour tour of New York City and a helicopter tour where he got to take in the city from the sky. He was in awe of the tall, tall buildings and was great and getting to stand in Times Square where Good Morning America was broadcast from. From Brave games to antique stores or an afternoon at the sale barn, he never met a stranger who would strike up conversations everywhere he went, wearing his well-loved cowboy hat that seemed to draw people in. Gary was preceded in death by his wife, Kay, of 59 and a half years, brothers Ted, Bruce, and Richard, parents Edward and Jesse, and an infant grandson, Wrangler Jerry Fry. He is survived by his daughter, Jekka Oshander of Gordon, Nebraska, and son, Greg Fry of Ashby, Nebraska. And I'll encourage you to read the names of Gary's 28 grandchildren and 26 great-grandchildren. The list is long, but his quiver certainly was full. At this time, I'd like to invite up Gordon Jones to say a few words. And if anybody else would want to come up and share a brief memory of Gary, you'd be welcome to.
I was asked to share some memories of Gary, and in talking, I cannot say Gary without saying Kay. And they were together every place I can remember seeing them, and they worked side by side, and so as I talk, I can refer to both of them. We became acquainted with Gary and Kay in 83. That's when Jan and I and our girls moved up here to the Sand Hills and to work for my uncles. And it was a distance from home. We were striking out in a new adventure. And Gary and Kay graciously invited Jan and I and our girls over to celebrate Christmas, Easter, and I'm not sure what else, but they invited us to be part of their family on some celebrations that we were so grateful for. And looking back at that now, it's like we were 180 miles from my immediate family and Jan's immediate family. And I think that Gary and Kay kind of knew what we were going through, because they struck out from our group to move up here to start a new life, and they probably understood what it was like to be away from home on holidays. And their friendship and their kindness is overwhelming. We just really appreciate it. Another memory that helping wasn't a pleasant memory. In the mid-80s, Gary and Kay had a house fire. And all the fire departments were brought in, and all the neighbors with their local trucks came in to fight the fire. And I don't know how I ended up on the roof, but I think it was myself and Malcolm. And the firefighters said that we need a hole in the roof so we can get the water to where the hottest of the fire was at. And I'm up there with an axe chopping a hole in the roof. And I don't know how long after that, but Gary came up to me and with kind of a stern look in his face, he kind of said, "Boy, I wish you wouldn't have had to put a hole in the road." And then a twinkle in his eye came and a smile, and he says, "But you know what? I've always wanted a skylight in my house." Another memory, Gary was a Gideon for many years, and several times we would go to meetings and be him and Kay and went to Bible distributions, and one of the greatest joys I think Gary had was passing out Bibles to high school kids or school-age kids, and I know that as each Bible that he passed out, that his prayer was that that person maybe would come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, as he was here as Lord and Savior.
Anybody else would like to know?
Gary was a great brother in the Lord. We were from Colorado. We started looking in Nebraska at different ranches. And we went to Boulder, Colorado for a Promise Keeper meeting. And the Promise Keepers would be 50,000 men on the stable when it was full. It was filling up and there was, we didn't know where to sit. We looked down about halfway up under the key seats. And there were some guys there with cowboy hats on. So we looked at each other, so that's where we went to. So we went down there and we sat behind this row of men. It was Gary and Willis Orr and Don Paulus and son-in-law, and a few others. But Gary was out there. He didn't know what we were about. Didn't take him any time at all to start thinking and let him know where we were with Jesus Christ. That was very dry. I want his grandkids and his great-grandkids to know that Gary loved the Lord. He loved Jesus, and the most important thing for him was to share that with people. Well, later on, we moved to Nebraska. I kept fishing around. You know, I remember this guy. He was so interested in us. And finally, somebody said, that was Gary Fry, and I thought, sound right. A few days later, Gary called and said, this is Gary Fry. He said, I want us to come over to your house and visit and invite you to church. So Gary and Willis showed up and they ministered to us. And Gary's way, he was in Quisby, but I didn't know where we were with the Lord. But Cindy wouldn't mind me telling him this. There was a classical guitar sitting there. And Gary says, you know, Willis knows how to play that. It never sounded quite like that before, has it? I cherish the friendship of Gary over the years. He was just a good friend and a good encouraging brother of the Lord.
Hi, I'm Drew Kate from Sydney, and the Fry family has been very special to us. Greg lived with us a little bit while he was going to school when we met, and the kids went to, and so my daughter, Debbie, was going to college, and they needed somebody in the hayfield, so Debbie came up and to work for Gary and Kay, and so she learned much a lot. Her mother cooked. I cooked, but Kay really did a lot, and she taught her how to make biscuits and all that stuff, and then she would hurry up and get her clothes on, and why she'd go out in the hayfield, and then she sometimes had to oil everything up, and Gary would laugh because she had more oil on her than she did in the bores and everything else, so they had to laugh about that, they always come to church here at Pleasant Point, and then at Bible school time, then my two younger ones would come, and they would come to Bible school, and then they were very competitive kids, and so they were learning all the Bible verses because they wanted to be the winners, and so they could get the brands on everything, and I still have the board with all the brands on that those kids did, And so Gary and Kay were great, instrumental in my kids going to the war. And then, of course, my son Justin, he worked for National Jacket. And that was a great experience for him. So the Pride family has been very special to us. And my husband was an auctioneer and real estate broker, Dale Caton, Sydney, and he was originally from Hemingford. And he and Gary, I mean, they had great conversations. They knew everything. And I was with Melon from Sydney, so he knew the Melon had been granted to her. So they had a great conversation, everybody knew everything. So it's just been a blessing for us. And we're going to miss Gary, and I'd love to see you smile. And you always have a smile for everybody. It's a new thing, we're all good.
Anybody else who wants to share another?
And then he would tell me whatever he's gone for.
And then he always ended his voicemail with, "This is Grandpa." Like, I don't know who you are. This is Grandpa. So he poured so much into so many. Even made social media, right? All our travels and things. And then this last trip in May when Durango brought him out. Because he had to travel since COVID and masks and all the things. It's not too hard, but it's been a while since he's been out. And so we had Durango come with him. And I got him on some Instagram lives and telling his story from South House and country and sandhills. And there were so many people that I thought, like, the impact he had on so many people was his smile. And I think even his warmth came through even a screen where people felt like they knew him just based on what they'd seen and what he'd share. And I thought that was really special. So often we don't know the impact or mark we're leaving on someone else's life just by a smile or a hello. We could go to a flea market or antique store shop in Atlanta. He'd get tired walking around, so he'd sit on the bench and he was tickled to sit there because he probably talked to every single person that walked in. Or they'd come over and like, "You're not from here," because he's dressed in his cowboy hat. So the idea of like, he just never missed an opportunity, like Bill said, to love on people, which is really incredible, and he's so outgoing. So I just want to share those things. Oh, and the helicopter in New York City. If you don't know the backstory there, I didn't know if we would be able to do New York City. That was like his first, when I asked him about where do you want to go anywhere in the world, and he said New York City. I'm like, okay, well, we could do New York City, but anywhere in the world. That's how Top Scotland came to be. And turns out, I wasn't paying much attention when I booked the flight, but we came back through JFK. And we had a tight layover, and I was able to extend it, so we had literally 8 hours. Never been in so many Ubers or done so much in New York City in a short time, but that helicopter flight was completely last minute from the air. I thought he would love it, it'd be so cool, so I booked it. We headed down there, I didn't tell him what I was doing. We sat there, and he could see them taking off over the Hudson. He thought that was pretty cool, and I said, okay, so like, what if we're gonna go up on one of those? That's what we're doing. He's like, "Oh, I don't think so." Like, "You don't want to go see the city from the air?" Nope. He was not, adamantly not going to do it. And I'm like, "Well, it's too bad. I already paid for it. It's not going to we're going." So, and I think that was part of it, was just like the courage it took for him to get in that chopper. It turns out, and one of his Barleans are here, apparently they took him up in the army in choppers, and those guys aren't so nice. The helicopter pilots in the service, and they were, but he would say they take him up and then they fly really low and try to mow the grass with the blades. So he had this massive fear going up in a helicopter, but it was turned out to be one of the best experiences. He just loved it, and seeing the city from the sky is pretty neat. So if you ever get to New York City, be in the street, but also be in the air. So thank you guys.
I just have a short challenge from Gary. You might say, "This is Grandpa Gary." He told me years ago, when they started going to Pleasant Point, there weren't any believers south of them. So he and Kay started praying. Don't forget that. This is Grandpa Gary. Pray.
Since Bill talked, I wasn't going to. Because Mary said when she said, I have to share this with you. When we moved here, I had to go to Hyannis to stay with the boys. And we started coming here to church, which God blessed us so much through this church. But we had this thing going on. We had been assigned people to pray with. And Gary and Kay were my partners. And so when I'd be in Hyannis, it wasn't long, is it? And we would pray for each other. I would pray for their needs, they would pray for my needs. And it was a really, really tough time for me in my life. Looking back, I'm really surprised I made it through. But Gary and Kay were awesome to me. and being my prayer partner, and just sharing personal things with me that nobody else knew about. They would pray, and they were very consistent with that, holding me up. I love them.
I want to encourage you that the sharing doesn't need to stop now. The sharing can go on tomorrow, the day after, the weeks after, the years after. You never have to stop sharing about Perry. This time we're going to listen to a song. It's called Where the Mountains Meet the Sky by Eddie Arnold. I'm told this is a special song for you. Today, on the day of his funeral, as we sit here and celebrate his life, Gary could materialize and stand before us in radiant health, what would he say? He would tell us that he has seen the face of Christ, and he cannot get over it. He would explain that he has experienced what has been promised to all of us. All of God's children in 1 John, verse 3, or chapter 3, verse 2. It says, dear friends, you're already God's children. But he has not yet shown us what we will be like until he has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like him, for you will see him as he really is. In a dazzling and sacred moment when Gary breathed his last and his heart finally stopped, he saw the radiance, the welcoming face of the Creator of the universe and the Savior of his soul. He saw Jesus face to face, eye to eye, heart to heart. He saw the face of Christ and he immediately became like him. In this world, Gary's sins have been forgiven through the blood of Christ. But in that instant, he became sinless like his Savior. And that sin became an impossibility to him. In this world, Gary, by grace, had been given the imputed righteousness of Christ, but in that blazing moment, righteousness became the air that he breathed. And then he was free from the limitations of his miserable body. So ravaged by age and illness, but at the consummation, Christ will transform Gary's lowly body to be like his glorious body. By the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. A body transformed by Christ to be like Christ himself. It's astonishing. I can't help but wonder what was Gary's first moments like in heaven. Or his first 5 minutes like, his first hour, his first day. I am excited to be there. But if Gary was standing here today, he would not only tell us about Christ, but he would assure us earthbound souls who are conditioned to think that only what is real is something that we can touch, that heaven is reality. Perhaps he would quote the Apostle Paul from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18, that says, "The things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal." He believed by faith, like many of us here today do. But now his faith has become sight. Gary is currently living in the real, the eternal. Christ is real. Heaven is real. And in this sense, Gary is more real right now than he ever has been before. Because like Paul said, we look not to the things that are seen, but to those things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. I can assure you that Gary would not come back if he could, except to tell us that what is real, and to urge us to make Christ known and be the focus of our lives. Talking with some folks this week about Gary, one of the most constant memories people were sharing with us was about his smile. I was lucky enough to be the recipient a few times of that smile. Several times in my brief moments of knowing him, I saw his smile. It's a smile I'll never be able to forget. And that warm smile that Gary gave was the icebreaker to many great conversations. I'm told Gary had the uncanny ability to visit with anyone and everyone he met. Receptionists, waitresses, anyone lucky enough to sit next to him on a plane, anyone who happened to walk by him on a sidewalk. It didn't matter who you were, where you were, Gary wanted to talk to you. But more importantly, he wanted to make you feel important. But it wasn't just an act. It wasn't fake. You truly were important to him. And I know that because you were important to Christ. And he wanted to share and tell you everything he knew about Jesus. And if Gary could come back today, Gary would tell us about Jesus. He would tell us about how great heaven is. He would also tell us about being co-heirs with Christ. It is customary to refer to the church of today as the church militant, and the church in heaven as the church triumphant. Sometimes the church here on earth fails at every task, but in heaven, the church is victorious. Gary right now is a part of the church triumphant. Part and parcel of the spirit of righteousness made perfect, as the writer of Hebrews calls those who have gone to heaven. And what is that perfection? Certainly, it is a perfection that comes from being delivered from our sins, but it includes more. It is the absolute perfection of our humanity, not only the moral defects, but the mental defects and the physical defects as well. Gary is now perfect, morally, mentally, physically. And he is glorious to God. He is sharing in the eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as the Apostle Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians. C.S. Lewis once said that if we could see somebody in heaven, if we could see Gary right now, our impulse, our initial impulse would be to worship him. As a member of the Church Triumphant, he is the firstborn son, which means everything along with every true believer, he is number one heir of everything in the universe. Indeed, he is a fellow heir with Christ. This is mind-boggling, but this is what Scripture tells us, that Gary is a co-heir with Christ. What else would Gary tell us about today? He would passionately affirm that the gospel is our only hope. The reason the gospel is our only hope is because we are so utterly sinful that it would, even in a billion lifetimes, we can never atone for our sins. And this is why Christ did the hardest thing ever done in time and eternity for us. The creation of the universe was merely an exercise of his creational power. He did it with a word, with an ease of his unequaled power. But the hardest thing ever was and is to say, my son, my daughter, you are forgiven. It's the hardest thing ever because it meant the death of Jesus on the cross. Listen to the words of Mark 14, verses 33 through 36. In the Garden of Gethsemane, the thought of his death was so horrific that the gospel writer tells us that Jesus began to be greatly distressed and troubled. He said to his disciples, my soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch. And going a little further, Jesus fell on the ground and prayed that if it were at all possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me. Yet, not what I will, but what you will. When that hour came, he did the Father's will by dying the lowest death of all, even death on a cross. During those three dark hours on Good Friday, Jesus' heart, so to speak, became a sea to which poured out the mountains of festering sin. There the mass of our corruption poured over him. There our sins were focused on Christ as he bore them, bore the fiery wrath of God, having become a curse, as the Apostle Paul says in Galatians 3. Jesus, in full lucid consciousness, writhing in the gloom and the pain, took your sin. He took my sin. He took Gary's sin. With the understanding and the pain that none can fathom. But the best part of it, that he did it willingly. He did it so that he could say, my son, my daughter, you are forgiven. Gary could stand here today, he would tell us that Jesus did the hardest thing ever, for you and for me. And that means that Jesus is committed to forgiving you as you turn to Him. Nothing is so beautiful as the gospel at a time like this. And that leads me to the last thing I believe Gary would want to tell us if he could right now. Gary would also want us to remember what the Psalms say about how short life is. Psalm 102 verse 11 says, "My life passes as swiftly as the evening shadows. I am withering away like grass." Psalm 90 verse 10 says, 7 years are given to us. Some even live to 80. But even the best years are filled with pain and trouble. Soon they disappear and we fly away. Gary was once a young boy riding his horse to school. He blinked. He became the young groom holding his newlywed in his hand. He blinked again. He's holding his baby daughter. He blinked one more time. He's holding his son. And he blinked one last time. He's holding hands with Jesus. Now is the time to get it right. Because our lives are short. Even the longest days we may experience will not extend the brevity of our life. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior and Lord today, if you don't have a personal relationship with the Creator of the world, if you haven't fully experienced that all-consuming love and forgiveness that God has given you, now is the time to do that. Gary wouldn't want you to leave this place right here, right now, without getting that done. Let's pray. Father God, it has once again been an honor to be in your presence this afternoon. I pray, Father, that as we remember the life of Gary today and moving forward, we would be reminded that our lives are but a brief blip in history, and our constant need is for your love, your grace, and your mercy. I pray in the coming days that we seek comfort in the Holy Spirit. I pray that we be encouraged as we look forward to the return of Jesus and remember that one day there will be no more death. There will be no more crying and no more pain. So we say thank you. Thank you, Father, for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to take our sin upon himself so that we may be reconciled to you forever. It is in Jesus' perfect name we pray. Amen. We're going to close with one more hymn. If you would open to page 542. That's the first and fourth verse of what we all get to thank you. saw him moving. You guys can sit back down. We'll start with our military hours.
to be the President of the United States, the United States Army, and the whole nation. Please accept this flag as a symbol of our appreciation for your loved ones' humble and faithful service.